So good morning, everyone. First, I want to thank you, the organizer, for inviting me. And today, I will talk about deep learning methods and with two main applications for the estimation of photometric redshift and also the classification of light curves. So just to highlight some important questions, the two current cosmological questions, which are the dark energy and the dark matter. And you know that we don't really know the nature of these components. And so there are several future surveys that are developed. So the first one that I represent is LSST, so the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope. It will observe the sky during 10 years. And thanks to its design, it is able to see the entire sky in 3 nights. So it will produce a huge quantity of data, around 200 petabytes, so it's a huge quantity, and we have to develop tools to deal with this quantity of data. And also, another future survey will be made by Euclid, so a satellite that will observe the sky in the same time of LSST, and for 6 years. And again, it's several billion of sources that will be observed. So we enter, in fact, in the area of big data. And you can see that this evolution is very quick. And the number of data that will be produced are very large compared to the other survey. And so in the same time, there is also the emergence of artificial intelligence. And so I did a request on ADAs that select the paper which contains the keyword machine learning between 2000 and 2019. And you can see here the distribution of the number of papers that are referred or non-referred that contains machine learning. And in fact, you can see that there is a growth factor which is very big. So the number of papers is really increased in the last years about machine learning methods. And I also did the request that contain deep learning, and it's the same behavior, but it's more recent, but still we have a lot of papers that are published on deep learning methods. So I will first of all present you some deep learning concepts just to explain the type of architecture that we developed and more on convolutional neural network as they are the type of network that I used. Then I will present the different problems that can be that they are in the classification. And the main problem is the problem of non-representativeness. I will explain it and also present different types of non-representativeness between the training and the test database. Then I will show a first application of photometric redshift, which is a more simple application without the problem of representativeness. And then another application on the classification of supernovae light curves, which contain the several problems of representativeness. And finally, I will conclude. So just to give you some important dates of neural network, in 1957, the perceptron was developed. So it's a simple architecture, as you can see here. So you have the input noted X and the weight noted W. And in fact, it is computed a scalar product between the input and the weights. And then a function is applied to produce an output, A. And so this type of very small architecture, so it's a neuron, can solve main problem of main linear problems. And so another type of architecture more complex was developed based on different layers which contain several neurons, which are the multi-layer perceptron, and that are more efficient and can solve non-linear problems by introduce non-linearity inside the network. And since 1998, it is the first type of the new type of architecture based on convolution developed by Lequin, where the neurons are in fact the several kernels of convolutions that will convolve the image and produce in this way new features. And since 2012, when the CNN won a very famous challenge called ImageNet, it was the starting point of this method, and now it's used in many applications. So to understand the efficiency of this method, I have to define, in fact, the difference between classical methods and deep learning. In classical method, you have an input data, for example, here an image of a galaxy, and you will extract different features that you consider are important for a problem. For example, you can extract the fluxes, the errors, the colors, and these are these features that the user has selected that are given to the classifier. In deep learning, in fact, you are free from this type, as it is the algorithm that will extract by itself the best features for a given problem. So it will extract with, for example, different kernel of convolution, the important features. And so they are very specified to a given problem, and that's why they are very efficient. So here you have one of the first famous architecture developed by Lequin, just to show you the different steps in CNN. You have, in fact, different layers of convolutions that will convolve the image, and also pooling layers that will, in fact, select a specific value inside the sliding window to reduce the size of the feature map. And it's important as it's very costly in memory. So to have a deeper network, we have to subsample the feature maps. And at the end, you have fully connected layers that will perform a classification step like a perceptron. And at final, you have the probability that the class, the image, belong to a specific class. So I will detail the different operations. For the convolution, here you have an image of a galaxy, and if we suppose that this image is composed of these pixels, and here the kernel of convolution, which is in fact a real kernel that I extracted in my network, and this kernel we convolve the input image to give a convolved image here. So the kernel is moving through the image with a certain stride, and the scalar product is computed inside the sliding window. And at the end, you have a feature map where a nonlinear function is also applied. So that is for one kernel, but in fact, in a CNN, you have a layer with several kernels. So here, I represented two kernels of convolution. And the network takes as input images, but in several bands. As in astronomy, we have different photometric bands. So here is UDRI and Z. And so the kernel, we convolved the input image in the five bands, in the five channels. That's why there is a depth of five here. And that produces images, convolved images for the five channels that are summed. And then a nonlinear function is applied and produce a feature map. And it's interesting in the first layer of the network to analyze, in fact, the feature maps, as they can give information of what is doing in the network. And the first one is quite interesting, as you can see that the galaxy and the stars on the corner are masked. So it's like this. The network is this kernel is specified to study the noise background and not take care of the galaxy in the first step. So in this way, we can analyze the behavior of the CNN, which is interesting and important. For the pooling, again, you have an image of a galaxy. And in fact, I represented it by this matrix here. And in fact, a sliding window is moving through the image with two pixels with a stride of 2 pixels, and value is selected inside the sliding window. For this example, it's the maximum value, so it selects 5, 7, etc. But you can use, you can select the average value, for example, which is which depends on, in fact of the problem. For photometric redshift, it was more interesting to select the average value as it can give the information of the background. And you have at the final an image which is reduced. And for the fully connected layers, so as I said, it's like a perceptron. So there are many neurons that are connected each one another and that perform the final step of classification. And at the end, you have a number of output neurons that correspond to the number of output classes that you want. So in fact, for the machine learning process, it's not perfect. We have some difficulties, and they are mainly due to the training database. As you know that in machine learning, we have to consider a database which contains examples where you have the truths, the label of, for example, the type of the object or the spectroscopic redshift. And this training database is often very small, as to have the truth on data, we have to make a spectroscopic follow-up, which is very costly. And so the consequence is a small training database, but this database is also biased with several problems of non-representativeness. Here I represent an illustration of the non-representativeness. In fact, you have in blue circles the training database data, and in red squares, the test database data. And when there is a non-representativity between the training and the test database, you cannot superimpose the two distributions, and this part here of the test database are not represented in the training database. So it's very complicated, as the algorithm has not seen this type of object, and so has not learned on this object, which creates a problem that we call in machine learning a problem of mismatch, which degrades the performance very much. And another problem can be due also to the nature of data. If you consider images, it's not a real problem, but with light curves, as you can see here, where you have the fluxes of an object in different photometric bands, the number of observations can be very small. There are not be the information of the flux in all the bands at a given time, and also the sampling is not regular. So it's a complex problem for machine learning also. So I will just detail the different problems of non-representativeness. The first is due to the spectroscopic follow-up. As I said, to know the truth of an object, we have to make a spectra of this object or to measure the redshift, as you can see here. But this spectroscopic follow-up is limited in brightness, as we need to have a lot of flux to make a good spectra. And so this limitness creates a problem at faint magnitudes. And here, I suppose that I make the observation with the 8-meter telescope, which has a high band limited magnitude of 23.5. And so that means that if we consider objects under 23, we can make a spectra of this object, and so we can represent this object in the training database. But at a magnitude above that 24.5, the spectroscopy is impossible, and so these objects are not represented in the training database. And there is an intermediate regime where the efficiency of spectroscopy is decreased. So that's why we have this kind of distributions, where you have here the distribution of the magnitude in the R band, and here of the redshift. And in blue, it's a distribution for the training database, and in red for the test database. And so, as you can see, there is a real shift between the two distributions. And the objects that are in the wing here of the distribution of the test database are not represented, or very few represented, in the training database. So these objects here cannot be seen by the algorithm during its training. And so this problem of mismatch is really critical for machine learning process. Yes?
Isn't it true that usually machine learning training data
It's not a realistic scenario if you have if you use the training database for both training and test. In reality, the spectroscopic follow-up will be limited, so we can consider this scenario, in fact. Do you mean that there is a problem of bias if I train also on the... Ah, there is more than a bias, the performance are very bad, in fact. And the purity is very small, so we are not sure that the supernovae, for example, detectees are real type 1a supernovae. So for cosmology after, it's a real problem. Yes? Sorry, can you repeat? I don't. Okay, define this. Okay, the training database, in fact, is the database that contains objects that you know the truth. For example, if you have images, photographies, for example, you will label on the photography there is a cat, there is a dog, etc. And so you give this type of photos to the algorithm. And in the test database, you don't have the truth. You don't give the label because you cannot, in astronomy, perform the spectroscopy until very faint magnitudes. And the validation dataset is, in fact, a part of the training database that you select to analyze the performance of your algorithm. And so you have the truth, but it's just to see if you have to add more layers, or etc. So it's more to test your algorithm. Okay. So there is another type of non-representativeness, which is due to the observational strategy. In fact, for LSST, it will have two kinds of strategies. The first is an observation of the sky in very small parts, represented by red squares, but with a deep photometry. And so the light curves will contain a lot of observation with small errors. And on the other hand, there will be an observation of a large part of the sky, so it's called the white fast deep field. And in this part, you will have a light curve that contain less points and whose the error bars are larger. So here you can see an example of two simulated data of the deep field on the left and for the white fast deep field on the right. And so you can see that there are less points and also the error bars are bigger. So it's also a problem if we want to train algorithms on deep fields, light curves, and test on white on the main survey. And in fact, it depends on the spectroscopic follow-up again, because we are not sure that a spectroscopic follow-up will be performed on the main survey. So it's interesting to develop algorithms that are able to be trained only on deep fields and can generalize after on the main survey light curves. So this is the other type of non-representativeness. And in the same ID, if you want to train the algorithm on simulated data and test then on real data, as you can see here, the simulated data are often too perfect to be compared to real data. And so this creates another problem for the algorithm. So the other thing that I consider it's very important is also to analyze and to understand what the algorithm is given as output. It's interesting to make an algorithm very efficient, but I think that it's also important to understand the different bias that you can have as output. And for that, when we make deep learning or machine learning, we have to analyze as output the probabilities and control that the behavior of the network is not dependent of physical parameters or observational parameters. And also to understand the limit of the model, because there are limits, and be able to consider at the final the confident interval that you can use for to make science after. So I will show you the first application of deep learning architecture for the estimation of photometric redshift. So you know that in cosmology, we need accurate redshift to constrain the dark energy equation of state, but also to study the large-scale structures. And up to now, it's more spectroscopic redshifts that are used because they are more precise. But there are other studies on photometric redshift. So it's redshifts that are obtained using only the photometry. You don't make a spectra of the galaxy to obtain the spectroscopic redshift. And there are two main methods that are used to estimate this quantity. The first one is template fitting method, where you match the broadband magnitude of a template with galaxy, sorry, with a suite of templates at different redshift range. And this method can be computationally intensive and also lead degeneracies in the color redshift space. So another type of method was developed based on machine learning. And so here you have an example of a Kanye West neighbor, which is a classical machine learning algorithm where you give the features. It's not deep learning. And they give very interesting results when the training database is large. And at the same time, more recently, another method was developed based on deep learning, but they give results that are comparable to classical methods. So in this work, we wanted to go further and develop our own architecture of deep learning to estimate photometric redshift of galaxies. But for this first step of this work, we wanted to consider a simple case, so without a problem of representativeness. For that, we make a cut on the training, on the dataset, on the magnitude and on the redshift. And we wanted to not only deliver the photometric redshift, but also the probability distribution functions associated, as we know that they are important input in many cosmological studies. Also, we wanted to make the algorithm immune to the image quality and the neighbors contamination and other parameters that I will present. So the algorithm, the CNN takes as input only images of galaxies, as you can see here, in the five bands of the SDSS data. And there are many information in the images, the color, the shape, etc. But there are also difficult cases. If you have, for example, the galaxy, which is larger than the image, or when there are several objects on the image. So there are many problems that the algorithm have to deal with. So the data that we use are the main galaxy sample of SDSS. And here you have the distribution of the spectroscopic redshift. So it's not a flat distribution, it's peak at 0.1. And I just point on this important region, Stripe 82, where in fact in this region the sky was observed several times. So the image quality in this region is higher than in the other part. So it will be interesting to compare the performance of the CNN on this part. So here you have the architecture. I have no time to detail it, but the main, yes? Yes, I perform data augmentation by making rotation of the images. You just rotate the image by an angle of 90 degrees, for example. Yes, it's very simple data augmentation for this part. So the network takes as input images, as you can see here. And the idea is was to not make a regression step, but a classification one. For that, we slice the input distribution in different bins. And the algorithm will give a probability that the true value of redshift is inside each bin. In this way, we can reconstruct at the end the PDF and also estimate the photometric redshift. So here you have the results that we obtain with the CNN on the left, and on the right is the comparison with Beck et al. So the method based on Kanewos neighbor. And you can see that there are clear improvement of the bias dispersion and the fraction of layers with our method. And there are no catastrophic redshift also. And here you have example of PDFs that are produced as output. So you can see that the true value is in red and the photometric redshift in blue. And even in difficult cases here where there are several objects on the image, there is a very small error, so it's really encouraging. So then we wanted to assess the quality of PDF, so verify that they have a good predictive power and represent well the error on the photometric redshift. For that, we use a statistical test called PIT, which is mainly used for this study. And the idea is to have a flat distribution if the PDF are well calibrated. In other cases, if the PDF are over or underestimated, you have convex or concave distribution. So in our work, we have a quite flat distribution with a slight over dispersion. So as I said, it's important to analyze the output with the different parameters. And so the first one is with the widening. So the algorithm can make confusion between obscure region and redshift dimming. So it is the case, in fact, if you don't give also as input the value of the widening, as it is not able to deduce the value by itself, as the images are very small, so they have no this information. And in fact, it's the orange line, so there is a bias. But when we integrate also the value of the widening inside the training, you can see in red that there is no more bias with this quantity, even if the number of examples here is very small. So it's really a promising result, as we can reduce in this way the bias by giving the information of physical parameters. Also, there is no bias with the disk inclination, which is not the case for most of the other methods. And here you have the summary results of our work. So the first is a result that I presented. So it's by considering 80% of the data set for the training. So it's a lot of images. And the idea is also to check that the algorithm is robust when we decrease the size of the training database, as again, we know that the spectroscopic follow-up is limited. And in fact, until by considering 20% of the data set, we reach a performance that is the same as by considering 80%. And with 2%, which is only 10,000 images, the results are comparable with the state of the art. So it's really promising. And another thing is that when we train and test only on Stripe 82, so it's the region that I presented just before, it's a region where the image quality is higher, we can have very good performance with few images. So there is a real compromise between the signal-to-noise ratio of the images and the number of images needed for the training. So now I will... Yes. Yes, it's a problem of mismatch of representativeness. And so the solution can be to degrade the training data to mimic, in fact, the test data. And it's, I will present this kind of mismatch. And in this way, the algorithm can be adapted also on more noisy data. Training on the best image quality No, it's not the it's not the good idea. In fact, if you have to test them, on, it's better in the other way. So I will present the second application. So it's an algorithm for the classification of light curves, and I applied on the supernovae classification to classify type 1a supernova and type non-1a supernovae. So this architecture is called, we call it Pelican, for deep architecture for the light curve analysis. Yes, it was the best thing that we did for that. And so this architecture is more complex than the other architecture, as it can deal with several problems of non-representativeness that I presented. It can also be trained on a small number of training databases, and we deal with the sparsity of data and the difference of noise and sampling. So here again, sorry, I have no time to detail the architecture, but in fact, it works in several modules. Each module will perform a specific task. The first one is a non-supervised learning with an autoencoder, which will reduce the mismatch between training and test databases, and also deal with the sparsity of data, as there is a regularization term inside the loss. The loss is, in fact, the function that the network will minimize. And the second block here is also dedicated to reduce again the mismatch with a loss that we build specifically for this task. And the third module makes the classification step. And so it takes as input only the light curves and no other features, except the weight shift that we can also give to make comparison. So I consider we consider different databases. The first one is the supernova photometric classification challenge, which was the challenge that was launched for the classification of supernovae. It's simulated data to mimic dark energy survey data, and in fact, all the algorithms have to be compared to this challenge to validate in fact data and to compare with other papers. Then we simulated data to mimic LSST light curve by considering different size of the training database, different problem of representativeness. And finally, we validate Pelican on real data. So for the SPCC challenge, we compare the result obtained by Pelican with Lochner et al. Method, which is the best method currently for the classification of supernovae. And so here you have the walk curve. In red is for Pelican and in blue for Lochner et al. By integrating or not the value of the redshift. And in fact, the performance are really good for Pelican by considering a non-representative training database. As you can see here, there is a shift between training and test databases. And so we reach an accuracy of 0.85, which is a very new result for this type of data. And you can see that there is a little decrease of the accuracy in a function of redshift, which is due to the number of training data example here, which is very small. So for LSST data, we perform two different methodologies. The first one is to train Pelican and test Pelican on deep fields. So with that, the problem of representativeness between a noisy light curve and good light curve. And the other step is to train only on deep field and test on main survey. So for the deep fields, we obtain very good results. And so if you consider the scenario which is realistic, that 10% of supernovae can be spectroscopically follow-up, so it's about 2,000 light curves for the training, we can have 85% of type 1a supernovae that are well classified with a precision above 0.98, which is one of our major results, as we are very confident with this object. And so for the behavior with redshift, it's quite robust until redshift of 1, where it slightly decreases due, again, to the number of examples. And here again, we compare with Lochner et al. So for the main survey, the performance are still good as we perform a huge data augmentation to make a deep light curve comparable to the light curve from the main survey to remove the problem of mismatch in addition of the non-supervised type, etc. And so we can, if you have 3,000 light curve for the training, we can detect about 72% of type 1a supernova with a comparison with a high precision comparable to the spectroscopy. So it's very encouraging for the future surveys. And for the behavior of in a function of redshift, there is a slight decrease at small redshift, which is due to the mismatch, but is really reduced compared to the state of the art. But it's difficult to compare with the state of the art as the algorithm developed by Lochner et al. Is not designed to deal with this type of mismatch, but is just to give a comparison. Then we wanted also to analyze the behavior of pelican with different parameters. So first of all, the number of observations, as pelican takes as input only the light curve, so it depends on the number of observations. But for the deep fields, this dependency is not very high, and the accuracy is still above 90% when there are a few points on the light curve. For the main survey, the tendency is increased, and the number of the accuracy depends more on the number of observations. Pelican is very robust to the signal-to-noise ratio, and it depends a few on the peak magnitude. As for faint magnitude above 26, there is a slight decrease, but again, it's a very small factor. For the white fast deep survey, there is again a consequence of the mismatch here, where there is a slight decrease at white magnitude due to the non-supervised step which is made on the test database. And finally, the results that we obtained for real data. So for that, we simulated SDSS data and we test on the catalog of supernovae data. And in fact, if we train only on simulated data, the performance are not very good. But if we had a small fraction of real data inside the training, so few about 10% of real data, so it's only 80 light curves, we can reach very good performance. So it's also an encouraging result, as the spectroscopic training database can be completed by a simulated data and so have an unlimited number of examples. So to conclude, we are in the area of big data, and we have to prepare the future survey with automatic tool. And this algorithm have to be synced to remove the different problem of representativeness, as we know that there is a real scenario that we will have to consider. And for the estimation of photometric redshift, the CNN show very good performance. And also for the estimation of light curve, Pelican is able to deal with this problem of representativeness. And the next idea is to adapt the algorithm to estimate photometric redshift as Pelican to deal with the problem of representativeness also for photometric redshift, and also to analyze the different bias that can be introduced by this type of method on the cosmological parameters. So thank you.